Good evening. Please join us in singing our gathering hymn. It's in the blue gather book. It's number 724, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say. The words will be up on the screen as well.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, as we gather again in your presence for the second evening of our parish mission, we ask once again, too, for a rich and full outpouring of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit who brings us the gifts of wisdom and knowledge and insight, so that we can use these gifts to respond to you and grow and develop into strong human and spiritual people. May your Spirit guide us again this evening, and may the Spirit find each of us open, attentive, and listening. We place this before you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At that time, Jesus exclaimed, "I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to the childlike. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by the Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Son except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
Everyone. Again, let me thank you for opening your calendars and coming along with me tonight. And a warm welcome to anyone who might be joining us from any of the other Catholic parishes in the area, but also a warm welcome to anyone who might be joining us from any of the other denominations. I encouraged you in my homily over the weekend not to be shy about inviting folks from other denominations. That's one of the reasons why we chose a scripture service in the evening and not a mass. Mass is available in the morning for those who would like to do that. And if it was another mass in the evening, when it came time for communion, these folks would feel excluded. We can share the Word of God, but we cannot share the Eucharist. And so it gives us some latitude to use the Scriptures and to appreciate them. And so I'm grateful that you have opened up your calendars to come along with me. And I'm also grateful, let me say this again, to Father Rob and the staff for allowing me to select my own theme and my own topic, because that is often not the case, but it is here. And these themes and these topics, as I said last night, are not chosen arbitrarily and off the top of my head. I have conversations with people, and I try to listen to what's going on in their lives, and then construct four evenings of reflection using the Scriptures and whatever else is available to sort of pry open, scalpel open the topic. And we are looking this week at this call that runs all the way through the Scriptures, that God has placed within us a hunger and a thirst for the more, so that we do not just become comfortable at levels of humanity, levels of intellectual life, etc., but that we're always open to exploring and developing and becoming mature, particularly in our humanity and in this gift of faith. I didn't quote him last night, but one of the people that would say something into this whole idea would be Andrew Greeley, if you remember Father Greeley of many years ago. He was a trained sociologist with a PhD in that field, and he also ended up at the end of his life writing a lot of novels, some of which some people thought were very racy for a priest to be writing. And someone said, how does he know all this stuff? Well, because priests hear confessions. And some people didn't like the fact that Father Greeley's novels were a bit racy. But Andrew Greeley made a very famous statement. He said, by baptism, Christians are not called to be settlers, where we sort of like find the turf and put the picket fence around and put the house up, and then we arm ourselves against anyone trying to come through the picket fence. He said, as Christians, we're called not to be settlers, but to be pioneers, so that we are open for growth, exploration, discovery, and so forth. And that would be a particularly significant frame of reference for people like you and me who are Americans, because that is very characteristic, especially of the westward expansion of the nation, and particularly during or after the Louisiana Purchase of 1831, when Thomas Jefferson tripled the size of the nation by buying that whole section of land from Napoleon Bonaparte, who had emptied the French treasury in useless wars, particularly the Russian campaign, and he was able to get a real deal, Thomas Jefferson. $20 million bought all of that land. Today, I have no idea what it would be worth, but Thomas Jefferson commissioned, after that was accomplished, as you know, the Lewis and Clark expedition. He wanted them to find a waterway to the west. They left from St. Charles, Missouri, on the Missouri River and the Mississippi River as they come together there. And they never found a waterway directly, but the fact that Thomas Jefferson was the guy that he was, he said to them, when you go out into that part of this country, you're going to see species of animals and flora and fauna and so forth, and I want you to send specimens of this back to me here in Washington. And that became the foundation of the Smithsonian Institution. He had never been out there himself, so one could ask the question, how did Thomas Jefferson know that all of these things were out there? Because Thomas Jefferson was a great reader. And if you go to his library at Monticello in the northern hills of Virginia outside of Washington, D.C., and see what this man read. Mathematics, agricultural techniques, especially botany, all kinds of things in history and religion and language. He was brilliant. And he read, are you ready for this? He knew what was out there because he read the Indian skins. The Indians, the Native American people, had developed, like the Egyptians, a hieroglyphics. And Thomas Merton learned how to read, Thomas Jefferson learned how to read those things. And they had all these pictures, these hieroglyphics, describing all this different kind of vegetation, etc. So he knew it was already out there. We are a nation, and it's not just us. God has seeded into us this need for growth, this expansiveness. And we're looking at that in this little parish mission this week because we sometimes don't do that. And we are challenged, I'm challenged and you're challenged, not to become settlers who have an answer to every question and we think that that's enough, but to become pioneers and to keep on moving, keep on expanding. We looked at that last night, and I mentioned a number of people, famous people, like Alexis de Tocqueville, and also some theologians like Teilhard de Chardin, who talks about a kind of evolution, a biogenesis, he calls it. We're all in an upward kind of development. I mentioned also Bernard Lonergan, the Canadian Jesuit, who used the image of horizons. Remember that if you were with me last night, that little kids, when they're born into the world, the little horizon at the end of their nose is very, very tiny. They are only interested in being held, having their diapers changed, and having something to eat. That's their perspective. But as we grow older and we encounter people and circumstances and events, et cetera, Father Lonergan said that horizon needs to be expanding, expanding, expanding. And therefore, as I said last night, the oldest person in this church or within the hearing of my voice on what are they, live streaming or whatever, the oldest person should have the widest horizon. And unfortunately, we know that that is often not the case. Some people go out at the end of their lives with horizons that are even tinier than the horizon with which they arrived. And one of the driving forces that limits that is the terrible, terrible situation of fear, fear of everything. I was a pastor in Kansas City a number of years ago in a parish that was in a very, very, very safe neighborhood. No violence, no disruption, and the Catholic devotion of First Friday, where we take communion to people who are in shut-in situations. The secretary would call on Monday and ask these lovely older people, do you want Father Simeon to visit you on Friday morning with the Eucharist? She would call again on Wednesday to make sure that they still wanted that. She would call on Friday morning as I was leaving to go and begin this little ministry around the neighborhood, and I would be banging and banging and ringing doorbells, and it would take some of these lovely people 10 minutes to unlock all the chains and all the chains and all the locks on the inside of their doors. And so we're not called to be unaware, but we're not also called to become caught in a constant worry and fear that something's going to happen. And that's all part of this growth, all part of this development. And we looked at that last night as an initial kind of thing, because I mentioned last night, let me repeat myself again, that God has given you and me two priceless gifts that He has not given to the rest of the animal kingdom, and those two priceless gifts are freedom of will and freedom of choice. And having created us in that way, He will honor that. He's not going to come like some kind of a jack-in-the-box and make things easy for us because we want them to be easy. He gives us what we need for the journey of life, and He wants us to exercise this so that the fruit of this engagement with the world and with issues and struggles and problems, etc., advances us and develops us and matures us. It develops character in us. And I'm not the first person, but I certainly would lend my voice as a teacher and a professor and so forth down through the years, that I am terribly concerned about our young people in this regard. And in that case, I would quote a famous book that was written in the last 5 to 10 years, Ben Sass, who has a doctorate from Yale, if I'm not mistaken, in education, and was the president of several small fundamentalist Christian universities. He's married, has, I think, three or four kids, and he's the former Republican senator from Nebraska. He's now left politics, and he was just chosen to be the president of the University of Florida. And he wrote a book a number of years ago called I want to get the title straight. It wasn't the shrinking the vanishing American adult. And his contention in the book is that we who are their teachers, we who are their parents, we who are their grandparents are running in and rescuing and ransoming all of our young people, and we are sparing them the difficulties and the struggles that gives people character in the development of their lives. And he said in the book, we're ruining them with not a malicious intentionality, but with an inept intentionality. We're not giving them what they need for the development of maturity and so forth in the journey of their lives, because we had for a period of time what they called helicopter parents, hovering and hovering and hovering. And these kids, even though they were away at college, were calling home to ask their moms, how do I make my bed? Because they had never been asked to do that. Mom had come in and made the bed and picked up the laundry and did the laundry and so forth. And if that wasn't bad enough, Ben Sass says in his book, now we have parents who drop the kids off at college and go to the registrar's office and get a copy of the kid's roster. And when the kid comes in to begin his college, her college career, one of the parents is sitting in the back of the classroom. The vanishing American adult. We're not doing them any favors by carrying on with them in that fashion. This is not a personal observation, but I agree with them. I've had students in some of my classes who, honest to God, believe that they deserve an A because they show up. They have no idea what they're getting into when they're in my class. If you're going to get an A, you're going to work and work and work again for that A. And a lot of them don't like that. And I gave a retreat several years ago to a group of nuns. There were about 35 of them. Every single one of them were presidents of colleges. This was in Nashville. And one of the nuns on that retreat said, you mentioned Ben Sass, but there's another book that you should also be aware of. And forgive me, it's written by two individuals. I don't remember their names, but the title of that book was called The Coddling of the American Mind. Don't let them experience anything that's difficult. That is so contrary to the theme of this mission, because we are called to engage and called to encounter, if only because all of this is not bad for us. It creates us and gives us depth. And so last evening when we gathered together, I said that that's the fundamental call, that we would grow and develop into this full human person. I quoted as Saint Irenaeus of Lyon, one of the early fathers of the church, who gave us that very famous statement that the glory of God is the human person fully alive. Not half done, half baked. No, the glory of God is given the glory that God is due because I cooperate with the graces that he's given me and become fully developed in every dimension of my life. Irenaeus of Lyon, I think his dates are probably second or third century. I could be wrong about that. But that's what we are looking at this whole week. And I suggested, at the end of last evening that if we want this growth to happen, one of the things that we have to turn around and look at are actually two challenges. We're not going to experience growth and development unless we also ask God for the grace of the healing of memories. Because every one of us is wounded. Every one of us has had experiences in the journey of life that have hurt us, and we have to heal these memories with the help of God's grace. Otherwise, they become a prison. And we keep going back to the divorce, keep going back to the kid that didn't do what this or keep going back to failed business deals, keep going back. We become imprisoned, we become paralyzed in the past so that we're not prepared for the present or the future. And that healing of memories, this is an ancient, ancient concept. The charismatic folks have grabbed a hold of that and used that phrase quite frequently, but they're not the ones that invented it. I mentioned last night St. Augustine, who wrote in the 5th century, he called it the conversion of manners. When you become a monk, he said, and enter the monastery, you have to let go of the old man or the old woman and become a new person, a new creature. And that's lifted right out of the scriptures, including the first reading from Sunday's Mass. That quotation, I've given you a covenant, you haven't been faithful to the covenant, and I'm back again, God saying, to offer you an opportunity to participate in a new covenant, and so that you have no excuse for not fulfilling your angle of the covenant, I'm not putting this covenant on tablets of stone and on manuscripts. I'm writing this covenant, this new covenant, I'm writing it on your heart. So you take it with you everywhere you go. And that covenant is a covenant of growth and development where we fall in love with God. And that he becomes, as he said, there is only one God and it's me. No strange gods in front of you. That's the first of the Ten Commandments, isn't it? It is. Only one God and it's me. And so we're dealing with this whole call to growth. Now this evening, having laid that kind of a foundation last night, I want to look at some insights this evening from a couple of our very famous, famous intellectual saints, not the least of which is St. Thomas Aquinas, the great Dominican theologian of the 12th century. But before we look at him, this whole notion of growth and development is precipitated by choice. Last evening, I mentioned God has given us two gifts that he hasn't given to the house pets that you've left at home. And the two gifts are freedom of will and freedom of choice. This is what defines us as human people and not animals waiting inside the front door for a treat. And that choice business is so absolutely central because he's never presented himself in the scriptures in any way, shape, or form as making things easy for us or taking us by the hair of our heads and making us do something that we haven't chosen to do. Having given us freedom of will and freedom of choice, he honors that and respects that. And we're grateful for that because we would be ending up in Ben Sasse's book with no character at all because everything had been made easy for us. It's not that God creates some kind of a boot camp and wants us to experience difficulty, but when the difficulties come, we have to see something positive in them, something that levels us, purifies us, empties us of ourselves and awakens us to the needs of our brothers and our sisters in the wider world of which we are a part. We're not called to live in some kind of igloo removed from the rest of humanity. We've been given these gifts, not the least of which is the gift of choice, so that we can make a difference in the world. And I learned this, believe it or not, when I was a kid in grade school, because I had a nun whose presence in my life made all the difference in the world. This is a woman who had spent most of her career teaching in Chile and in Peru, in Latin America. She developed a very serious heart condition, and they brought her back to Philadelphia, and they put her in teaching seventh and eighth grade kids. That was recuperation. And she would often say to us, not what are you going to do to become famous? What are you going to do to become wealthy? What are you going to do to become powerful? She never went down that road. This nun always said to us as kids, what are you going to do in the journey of your life to make a difference in the world? We're here for that. And we have all that we have, the gifts and talents, not that these terminate in ourselves, but that we can share them and make the world a better place for everyone. I learned that as a kid in the seventh and eighth grade. And she was the one who sent me, you know, she said to me, if you're thinking about the priesthood, you need to go to a religious order, because she said you will never survive as a diocesan priest, especially in Philadelphia. She said, you need to have people living in the house with you. You need community. And I had no idea in the seventh and eighth grade what the nun was saying to me, but now I realize that. I live with eight other friars in the house in Denver. The other seven are weird. I'm the only one that's perfect, you know, but nevertheless, I'm grateful to God that that nun directed me. And when I go back to Philadelphia, I visit two graves, my mom and dad and Sister Peter Claver, because she sent me on my way. And I wasn't the only one. There were 60 kids in that classroom, and she sent 12 of us into the convent and into the religious life and into the priesthood. And every single one of us are still at it. And I'm 53 years a priest this year. And so the influence, what are you going to do with yourself to make a difference? What are you leaving behind? Buildings and bank accounts and cars? And no, you should do something that makes the world a better place for other people. And so this challenge to become all that we can be, but it's based in this great gift that God has given us, and it is the gift of making choices, making decisions, choosing. Now, this is where I go to Thomas Aquinas, because Thomas Aquinas, if you're familiar with him, he was born in the 12th century in Italy, and he was the third of three sons born into this noble family. His father was a count, the Count of Aquino. The parents were not concerned about son number one, because by the law of primogeniture, the firstborn son in these families, by the freak accident of being born first, got everything. They got the noble title when the father died. They got the castles, the real estate. They got the money. If there were slaves, they got the slaves. And so they weren't concerned about son number one. Second-born sons in these noble families were supposed to make a name for themselves, either in the military or in the world of diplomacy. And the second-born son was doing that. And then here's Thomas. They couldn't even get this kid to talk at the family dinner table unbelievably shy, unbelievably withdrawn. The parents started a little school in the basement of the castle to give the kids in the village an opportunity for an education, and they put Thomas in there, hoping that interacting with the other kids would draw him out of himself. Just the opposite happened. The kids turned on him and they bullied him, as kids often do. They called him the dumb ox. Dumb because he never seemed to understand the question that the teacher was asking, and they called him the dumb ox because Thomas Aquinas, from the day that he was born until the day that he died, struggled all of his life with what today we would call morbid obesity. He was immense. We have mosaics on the walls of Italian cathedrals that were put there within 100 years of Aquinas' death, and he's always portrayed in a very portly fashion. They had to cut a half moon in the table where he sat to eat so that he could fit his stomach in there. If this was 21st century postmodern America and medicine, they would come up with some protocol for the kid. But we're talking about 12th century medieval medicine, and so they didn't know what to do with the kid. He heard about a new religious order being started by a man from Spain called Dominic Guzman. And Dominic had this idea of forming a crack corps of preachers who would go out all over Europe and by their preaching win fallen away Catholics back to an active practice of their Catholic faith. They're officially called the Order of Preachers, but popularly, because Dominic founded them, they're called the Dominicans, and the Dominicans accepted him. They tutored him by sending him to one of their most brilliant members, a man who taught science at the University of Cologne in Germany. His name was Albert. He became eventually a bishop and eventually a doctor of the church. Very important writings. And when Albert worked with this youngster, he discovered that under that terribly shy personality and temperament, and hidden under that enormous body weight, is one of the greatest minds that God had ever created. And Thomas Aquinas is as important as he is because he was very pragmatic in his theological writings. Many of us in this room this evening, could I ask you by way of a show of hands, how many of you, like me, learned about our Catholic faith as a kid by studying the Baltimore Catechism? Because when the bishops of our country in 1863 commissioned a team of theologians to come up with a catechism, they went to the writings of St. Thomas Aquinas, and they distilled and distilled the complexity of his thinking. And when you and I were studying the Baltimore Catechism, we were studying Thomistic philosophy and Thomistic theology. His influence is in this church this evening. And Thomas is as valuable as he is because, unlike other theologians who were very important, like St. Bonaventure in the Franciscan tradition, St. Anselm of Canterbury in the Benedictine tradition, these other theologians were very mystically oriented, and their theology, it takes you into the heavens. Whereas Thomas Aquinas said, let's bring this down. My father would have loved him, because my father always said, be concrete and be practical. And that's where Aquinas said, if you make the choice, given all that God has given you, freedom of will and freedom of choice, what is the choice that you make? You make the choice to live a virtuous life. a virtuous life. And the decision to live a virtuous life does not happen just because you wish it. There is a process that takes you in that direction. That's Aquinas, and he laid out what the process is, and I'd ask you to take this into consideration for your life and my life tonight, because Aquinas said you can wish all you want to live a virtuous way of life, but in order to accomplish that, there has to be concrete steps, and the first of these steps, he said, you have to begin to develop practices. Practices. Like a kid. The kid gets out of bed in the morning, and she has to be taught how to wash, take a shower, throw water on their face or whatever, how to put the toothpaste on the brush before they come down for breakfast, and do these kinds of practices in order to create ultimately habits, and habits come natural. They might fight you and argue with you, etc., as you're trying to teach them to develop these kinds of practices, but once they get that under their belt, then they move from just practices into habits, which means it's just the normal thing. They get out of bed in the morning and they brush their teeth and they get dressed and they come, and there's no hassle, there's no screaming and hollering. Aquinas said, if you want to practice the virtuous life, you have to do these kinds of steps. Why? Because this is not accomplished overnight, and it's not accomplished just because you will it. You have to do something to accomplish it. And so we're called to live a virtuous way of life, and in essence, what does that mean? That we make wise choices. We take other people and their needs into consideration. That we struggle to be a woman and a man of integrity, which means that the outer person and the inner person is the same person. A virtuous life, and while Aquinas spent a great deal of time talking about this virtuous way of life, he was not the first person. He did something in the 12th century that had he been caught doing this, we would not be calling him Saint Thomas Aquinas. There were five great universities in Europe in the Middle Ages, and all five of these came out of the great Benedictine libraries in monasteries and abbeys that were all around through the Middle Ages. What were the five great universities? Salamanca in Spain, in Paris in France, Prague in Czechoslovakia, Padua in Italy, and Oxford in England. All of those universities came out of the great Benedictine libraries. And if you were teaching theology in any of these particular universities in the Middle Ages, you were absolutely forbidden, under pain of being arrested by the Inquisition and burned at the stake, absolutely forbidden to read any of the writers of ancient Greece and Rome. They were pagans. The attitude was, they have nothing to offer us. Well, late at night, when the rest of the university was asleep, with the light of a candle, Thomas Aquinas read the ancient pagan writers, particularly Aristotle, because, and he did not do this in defiance against the church, he did it because he realized that the Catholic Church does not have a monopoly on the truth. Truth can be found in many places. And he read Aristotle. And he discovered that Aristotle wrote a very important book if you're interested in doing this, called the Nicomachean Ethics. And we might go back and reconsider this, because what Aristotle said in the Nicomachean Ethics is that when you deal with other people, especially in community settings, you have to be sensitive to the other. You do not turn on a radio blaster in a public setting and subject everybody there to your crazy choice of music. You have to be sensitive to the community. We need a whole new ethic and a whole new etiquette in order to handle this, because we're sinking ourselves deeper and deeper and deeper into a materialistic society and into a materialistic world. And while I would be the last person on the face of the earth to think that these devices are not significant and important, the problem is that these devices are replacing us. Excuse me, let me take this phone call. Excuse me, let me take this phone call. What about the person standing in front of me? This person is no longer important. I'm going to take a roto call. And this is even penetrating into places of worship. Before every Mass that I've been to around the country, the lector will say, out of deference to your fellow worshipers, please mute or turn off your cell phones. And inevitably, at every Mass, someone's cell phone goes off because they're thinking, that doesn't apply to me, and I'm more important than the community at worship. The Nicomachean Ethics said, wise up, you are not living in an igloo. You're living in community with other people, and there needs to be respect, there needs to be honor, there needs to be dignity and care extended to these other people as we want those other people to extend dignity and respect and honor to us. And so it's not just Aquinas, it's the pagan authors of ancient Greece and Rome that talked about the importance of living a virtuous way of life. And we have to make a choice to go in that direction. And Aquinas says, you make the choice because you did practices that led you in that direction, and the practices created habits, and the habits lead to making the choice for a virtuous way of life. Nothing happens just on its own. It is the result of process, the result of format, the result of development. And I would agree with him and with Aristotle in the Nicomachean Ethics. We are called to live a virtuous way of life, and that is a very important thing for us to choose over and over and over again. And here's the issue. Let's move this to my father's desire to be practical. That's one of the reasons why we have a couple of things that help us to move in that direction, pragmatically speaking. That's one of the reasons why we believe in the power of the third person of the Blessed Trinity, whom we call the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, maybe my generation, if any of you are here this evening, you know, we had this concept that you turn to the Holy Spirit when you have a major exam at school, an exam for which you have not studied. And during the night, the Holy Spirit will come and give you infused wisdom in mathematics. Or you turn to the Holy Spirit when you look through the rearview mirror and see the state trooper coming up behind the car with the ticket book already opened. We should pray to the Holy Spirit in those kinds of situations, but that's not why the Holy Spirit has been poured into us. And the Holy Spirit has been poured into us. Go back with me to Ascension Thursday, if it was a Thursday. That's why we always say Thursday, but it could have been a Tuesday when Jesus went back to his Father. He said to the apostles, I am not abandoning you. I'm going ahead to prepare a place for you, and when your turn comes, I will return and take you there with me, because in my Father's kingdom, there are many, many mansions. There's room for everybody. I'm not abandoning you. I'm going ahead of you. And when I come back and take you there at the end of your life, in the meantime, I'm pouring the Spirit into you, the Spirit of common sense, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of rational thinking, the Spirit to guide you so that you do not end up making choices. Here we are back to this. Choices that do not take you forward, but choices that arrest you, stunt you, and maybe even abort you in the journey to the wholeness of life that God wants you to experience. I'm pouring my Spirit into you. We would say in Catholic theology, the Spirit is poured into us at baptism, strengthened in us later on in the sacrament of confirmation, renewed within us every single time we receive the Eucharist or go to confession. The Spirit is poured into us so that we do not make stupid choices that take us in the journey of our life into unhappiness and misery. That's why the Spirit, it's not to get out of speeding tickets, and we need to re-envision that whole theology of the Holy Spirit, and we need to climb out of bed every morning and pray that the Holy Spirit is active and alive in the course of the day so that we do not make stupid decisions, because that is not what takes us to a virtuous life. And the one example, forgive me, I probably have used this 1,000 times, and some of you have been good enough to come to parish missions around the diocese as well as here. But I was a pastor years ago in a parish, and I was working with a woman who was seeking an annulment for her marriage. And as we were doing the documentation, she wrote in the documentation that she was standing in the back of the church on her wedding morning, surrounded by her bridesmaids, already resting on the arm of her father, as the organist began to play the bridal march in the choir loft above their heads that would bring them all down the aisle. And she said, I looked down the aisle, and what did I see? My groom standing at the base of the aisle, surrounded by all of his groomsmen. And she said, I took one look at him, and I turned to my maid of honor, and I said to her, why in the name of God am I marrying him? I don't love him. On her wedding morning, down the aisle she came, married him she did, and 20 years and 6 kids later, the marriage exploded in their faces because it was a marriage that should never have been entered into to begin with. What was going on in the back of that church on that wedding morning? It was a moment in the Holy Spirit where the Holy Spirit was saying to her, it doesn't make any difference that the embossed invitations have been sent out. Don't go down the aisle. It doesn't make any difference that the band has been hired and the hall has been rented for the reception. Don't go down the aisle. It doesn't make any difference that the color scheme of the bridesmaids' dresses is replicated in the icing on the wedding cake. Don't go down the aisle. Down the aisle she came, creating 20 years of unnecessary misery for 8 people, the 6 kids, herself, and the husband. Is this what God wants from us? No, it is not what God wants, but there are choices that need to be made that we don't come down the aisle. And that's why the Spirit is poured into us, so that we do not end up living lives that are filled with unhappiness and misery, because that's not what God wants for us. He says this, "I have come that you may have life and have it to the full." I have come, he said, that my joy may be in you and your joy will be complete. Living a virtuous life means I've got to choose to go in that direction, and I'm not left unassisted in making those choices because the Spirit has been poured into me so that I don't go down the aisle. It's all about choices. And we are not left to figure all this out on our own. And when we don't pay attention to the Spirit, we make unbelievable mistakes. I had 4 of those 6 kids in my classes at the university, and I know that those 4, I suspect all 6, but those 4, they have spent hundreds of thousands of dollars in the journey of their lives in psychotherapy, trying to reclaim the childhoods that they never experienced, being raised by 2 parents that should never have married each other. And so, the practical ramifications of this beautiful theology is that we have to listen to the Spirit. And then I would add something else, and that is the use of the sacrament of reconciliation. Because this is a sacrament, I think, take it for Gallagher's worth, but I think we have these 7 sacraments in the Catholic Church. A lot of people consider them as kind of things. When did you get First Communion? When did you? They're not things. They're sacred moments in which God enters into the life that we are living and gives himself to us in unique and powerful ways so that we become conformed to a virtuous life and end up filled with happiness and peace. We have a sacrament that begins life and a sacrament that ends life. We have a sacrament of commitment, in fact, 2 of them, marriage and holy orders. We have a sacrament that feeds us and nourishes us in terms of living in a decent life and a virtuous life, namely the Eucharist. And we have a sacrament, thanks be to God, namely the sacrament of reconciliation, where we can acknowledge that we're not the hotshots that we think that we are, and that we always have all of our ducks in a row, and everything in my life is perfect because I have my act together. The problem is we might have our act together, but we don't know where in the name of God we left it. And we have a sacrament that puts us, restores a kind of, it's like a Geiger counter. It puts us back in the right direction. And this is the 7 sacraments of the Catholic Church. This is the sacrament that has received, in my estimation, the worst catechesis, the worst explanation. And it's tragic because this is a sacrament where Christ extends himself to us in mercy, in compassion, and forgiveness. And I don't think a lot of people have been trained to think of the sacrament in that fashion. I think a lot of us received Orthodox Catholic theology, but I don't think it went far enough. And as a result of that, this John Paul II God love him, Pope for 27 years. He wrote a number of things, encyclicals, apostolic exhortations, the guy was prolific, but he left 35 encyclicals. One of these dealt with the sacrament of reconciliation, and on Holy Thursday, which is the annual feast day for priests to renew their commitment, because it's traditionally the sacrament was initiated or expressed in that day on Holy Thursday at the Last Supper and so forth. That's the day that Jesus restores us and renews us in our priesthood. But John Paul II said in one of these 20, every year he wrote a letter, and a preponderantly large number of these letters deals with the sacrament of reconciliation. And he said one of the most serious obligations incumbent upon Catholic priests today is to help our Catholic people understand that when you come to confession, you are not coming to a counseling session. That's an altogether other forum. When you come to confession, he said, and it's true, this is a sacrament of self-confrontation, that we come in with profound humility and hopefully to God, self-awareness, and say, Father, I am here because I am a liar. Name it. Let me hear, like they have in AA. If you've been to any AA meetings, when someone stands up to say a few words of encouragement and sharing their stories with the other people at the AA meeting, they begin the statement by saying, my name is John and I'm an alcoholic. To hear themselves saying that, and the purpose of coming to confession is not to talk about marriage problems, family difficulties, financial setbacks, that's counseling. The purpose of coming to confession is to confront myself. Father, I am here because I am a liar, and through my lies, I have destroyed the reputations of people where I work. I've destroyed the reputations of people up and down the street where I live. Father, I am here because I am a thief. I have never left my place of employment without filling my pockets with things that don't belong to me, but that I have taken from my place of employment. Father, I am here because I am an adulterer or an adulteress, because in the whole history of my marriage, I have never been 100% faithful. Say it. And that brings us to the reality of my life. And I make a choice as a result of coming to confession to once again pick up this virtuous life and move forward, because I maybe pointed my finger out at everybody else and accuse them of everything else. And coming to confession reminds me, if I'm pointing my finger out toward everybody else, there's a thumb pointing back to me. And that is a way of leveling our hypocrisies, our self-adulation. I'm quite concerned about this, because it's no secret for me to say to you here this evening that something has happened in the Catholic community. Because in the last 50 years, the lines for confession have become shorter and shorter. But the lines for communion have become longer and longer. Is it possible that we have lost a sense of sin? I can't choose a virtuous way of life unless I make the choice to go in that direction. And if I don't think I need the sacrament of reconciliation to achieve that because I'm perfect, God help me. None of us are perfect. I should say this evening. If there is a finished, 100% perfect person in this church tonight, please stand up so we can give you a round of applause. We're not perfect, and this is not a sacrament that should fill us with fear. It's a sacrament that helps me to be at peace because I am sinful like everyone else. That's why, let me say this again, I love Pope Francis. A lot of people don't like him. That's their issue. But this guy was asked the first year that he was Pope, he was coming back from one of these foreign journeys, and one of the journalists asked him, "Who are you?" And Pope Francis said, "I am a sinful man." Can you imagine anyone in Washington making that statement? Because when you stop and think about it, everything that we are and everything that we have has been given to us. We would not be in this church tonight if God had not given us the breath of life and the oxygen and so forth. The only thing we can claim as our own are our sins. We are the recipient and the beneficiary of everything else we have and are. And for that man to say, "I am a sinful man," is the most fundamental and realistic self-proclamation. A lot of people don't, I can't imagine Putin saying that. I can't imagine anybody around the world saying that, and certainly no one in Washington has come up with this. And so, coming to confession, it's a way of returning to a virtuous way of life because we can slip away from this. And then the third thing, and with this I'll finish. Aren't you happy? The third thing I swipe from the writings of St. Ignatius of Loyola, who founded the Jesuits. This is a guy who is of incomparable value. I hope that St. Francis of Assisi doesn't disown me, but if someone were to say to me, "Who was the greatest retreat director, mission preacher, who was the greatest spiritual advisor?" Without a moment's hesitation, I would say Ignatius of Loyola, because this guy was so absolutely insightful. And Ignatius suggested, by way of coming to the awareness, the consciousness of who I am, and the call to live a virtuous way of life, he suggested to the early Jesuits something that is called the particular examen. Better put and more understandably put, the examination of consciousness, not the examination of conscience. That's what we do before we go to confession. The examination of consciousness means that I take the time. He suggested to the early Jesuits that they do it 7 times a day. For you and me, that might be a bit extravagant. But at the end of the day, before we turn off the nightlight and make a day of it, to look back over the day and to see the way I behaved, to see the way I treated people, the way I interacted in doing the duties, the obligations, and the responsibilities that are incumbent upon me because of the priesthood or marriage or my job or whatever, to look back over the day and become conscious of the way I have lived that day. And then we do that and we realize, why did I treat that cashier at Walmart the way I treated that person? She was only trying to do her job, but in my arrogance, I became impatient because the little lady that was in front of me was measuring out her bill in pennies from a little purse, and I'm so terribly important that I shouldn't be kept waiting. And I suddenly become aware that I didn't just do that today. That is a constant way I do life in relationship to everyone. I'm filled with myself, filled with my arrogance, and I am coughing these spores of negativity into absolutely every situation. I spend the whole day whining, griping, and complaining about everything. My first reaction to everybody and everything as they come down the road toward me is a reaction of negativity, negativity, negativity. I don't see anything good in anybody. I'm horrified when I become aware that that's the way I'm living my life. The examination of consciousness, because tomorrow is another day, and we can make the effort tomorrow to change the way I have lived my life today. This God of the Judeo-Christian tradition is a God of second chances, third chances, fourth chance, and he never gives up on me because he loves me in spite of myself. But I have to interact with that and pursue the virtuous way of life. And I'm not left to figure this out because of the presence of the Spirit that has been poured into me, because of the importance of the sacrament of reconciliation, and this little spiritual exercise of looking back over the day and asking myself, why did I white-knuckle the steering wheel and drive like a bat out of hell in traffic today, shouting obscenities at everybody that was on the road because they weren't driving fast enough, they weren't going through traffic lights quick enough, and that guy had the nerve to take my parking space at the mall. And suddenly I become aware, I am far away from living a virtuous way of life. And it's a way of, with God's help, reclaiming that virtuous way of life and making the choice, making the choice, making the choice this day, tomorrow, the next day, to live the kind of life that respects other people and treats other people with dignity and honors them. My mother, I would like to finish with quoting her in her wisdom. She used to look at me and say to me, you know, you are not the center of the universe. And I was raised with the mantra, get over yourself. Get over yourself. And that rings in my ears all the time from my wise immigrant Irish mom. She restored me to a virtuous way of life just by looking at me sometimes. And so, tomorrow we'll take up some other aspects of this, but let's just finish tonight with a little bit of quiet thinking, maybe a little bit of music playing in the background, and we'll finish with common prayer, and then for the night we're finished. All right, so let's just sit for a moment and think. Thank you. It might seem unusual to suggest that we pray together the Confiteor, which we pray at the beginning of Mass, but when we take it out of the natural context of Mass and listen to it, we hear this awareness of treating each other, brothers and sisters and so forth, praying for each other, forgiving each other, and working together. So I'd like for us, if you remember those words without them having written down somewhere, to pray that with me tonight. So please rise. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in thoughts and what I have done. Through my most grievous fault, therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he turn his face to you and have mercy on you. May he show you his countenance and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our final hymn is number
651.
It's on the screen.
Open my ears.